Now time for a question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Royal Opposition.
Thank you, Speaker. Question to the Premier. Premier, this morning I addressed the Roma Good Roads Conference, and I talked about our plan to create 1 million jobs in our province over the next 8 years. So while we were presenting our plan for good jobs in our province and better take-home pay, the Liberal government was more concerned about restaurant menus. So while we're counting on creating more jobs, your focus is on counting calories. So let me ask you a very direct question, Premier. How many additional jobs will your restaurant menu legislation create in the province of Ontario?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Well, you know, the role of government is to do many things at the same time, Mr. Speaker. And in fact, you know, I noticed the grade 5 students from Blessed John the 23rd who have joined us this morning. And the menu labeling initiative that we've brought forward, Mr. Speaker, is at least in part to make sure that those young people who happen to come from the riding of Don Valley West, that they have all of the supports that they need to make sure that they grow up healthy. So, Mr. Speaker, we're going to continue to bring forward education initiatives. We're going to continue to bring forward health initiatives, Mr. Speaker, and we're going to continue to bring forward initiatives that will invest in businesses, support businesses to create jobs.
Answer.
All of those things at the same time, Mr. Speaker. That's what government has to do.
Well, respectfully, Premier, I want to see when students grow up and they graduate that they've got a good job in the province of Ontario. And really, shouldn't that be our number one priority? I mean, I was certainly edified by your health minister's debate about what has more calories, a cheeseburger or a raisin muffin. But respectfully, I think the bigger debate is, how are we going to get people back to work in the province of Ontario? How are we going to get energy costs under control? How will we get taxes down so all businesses can succeed in our province? And I know you can do this because time and time again, the New Democratic Party props you up no matter what you do. You've been given a license to bring forward secondary bills instead of dealing with the true issues around jobs and the economy. So if they're going to prop you up again two times today, let me at least ask you
question.
This. Will you set aside your restaurant menu legislation and clear the way for my 1 million jobs plan to go back to your province?
You see it, please? You see it, please? Thank you.
Much, Mr. Speaker. Well, the leader of the opposition can minimize health initiatives, Mr. Speaker. He can minimize clean air initiatives like green energy, Mr. Speaker. He can undermine and try to minimize education initiatives. But from my perspective, the economy is all of those things, Mr. Speaker. Having healthy people, having an educated workforce, having businesses that are supported, having infrastructure that's in place, all of that is part of a healthy economy, Mr. Speaker. So, he can compartmentalize and...
That'll do. The member from Northumberland will come to order.
Compartmentalize, Mr. Speaker, and pretend that the health and well-being of our students is not part of a strong economy, but that is just not the case. So, Mr. Speaker, I want to make sure that as the jobs that we are creating, for example, at Conestoga Meatpackers in Breslau, 425 existing jobs and 100 new jobs, Mr. Speaker, because of investment. Centerline at Windsor, 31 new jobs and retaining 482 existing positions. I hope he would support those, even in his compartmentalized view of the world.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
You think you can hold everybody's hand,
please? I know the Premier wants to hold everyone's hand 24 hours a day.
Minister of Rural Affairs, come to order.
I want to see business succeed again. So, while the Liberal Party seems lost in a maze of secondary legislation, we have a very clear-eyed vision to get Ontario back on track with more jobs and less debt. And I want to say, Speaker, I am proud to introduce today the new member for Thornhill, Gila Martin. He's going to be a tremendous asset here in this legislature. But I'll tell you this, Premier, when Gila Martin and I were knocking on doors in Thornhill, I didn't hear people saying, moms and dads, we want you to focus on counting calories. They want us to focus on counting that their kids have a job when they graduate from school. So put that aside, pass our bill, let's put people back to work.
Thank you. You see it, please? You see it, please?
Premier.
Mr. Speaker, and I want to welcome, and I should have done it off the top, I want to welcome the new member for Thornhill to the House. Very, very welcome. Great to have you here. Mr. Speaker, this sounds like flip political rhetoric that's coming from the leader of the opposition. But, Mr. Speaker, it's actually much more serious than that, because what the leader of the opposition is saying is that an economic plan and a jobs growth plan has nothing to do with the health, the education of the people of this province. That is just not the case, Mr. Speaker. So when Cisco Systems Canada came to Ontario and is adding 1,700 high-tech jobs, Mr. Speaker, with a potential of 5,000 jobs by 2024, and we supported that, Mr. Speaker. We're working with Cisco. So we've created those jobs in partnership with Cisco. And the leader of the opposition, Mr. Speaker, suggests that that's not related to education. Well, we know that the prime reason that Cisco came here is because of our educated workforce. They are connected. You cannot slash those services and have a strong economy, Mr. Speaker.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please.
Thank you. New question, member from Whitby, Oshawa.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Health. Minister, Community Care Access Centre executive salaries have skyrocketed over the last few years. In 2012, the average salary of the chief executive officers at the
training college universities come to order.
In Ontario was $234,000. In one case, its salary jumped by over 50% in 3 years. Compare this to the average personal support worker, who makes an average of about $20,000 a year, who hasn't seen any pay increase over the last 3 years. Minister, your government is now spending over $30 million on executive salaries alone at the 14 CCACs and the Ontario Association of CCACs. Yet, I consistently hear from seniors and families of individuals with developmental and other disabilities across the province that they are unable to access needed care. Minister, can you tell us why you have allowed executive salaries to skyrocket over the last 3 years?
Thank you, Speaker. And we are concerned about executive compensation, not just in the health care sector, but in the broader public sector, Speaker. And I will ask the Minister of Government Services to respond in the supplementary. But I do want to underline, Speaker, that our commitment to health care transformation is built on home care, Speaker. We are investing more in home care so
the
more
from
people
Northumberland
can get the care they need at home, so they don't have to stay in hospital and they don't have to go into long-term care before they really need that kind of intensive care. 200,000 more Ontarians are getting home care now, 200,000 more now than in 2003 when your party was in charge. We are getting people home from hospital more quickly.
Answer.
We are providing better care, Speaker. I will stand with those frontline providers. I will stand with home care, Speaker, because that's the investment we need to make.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, whatever investment the minister says has been made is clearly not being made on the frontline services. I hear from people across the province who are desperately trying to access services through their CCAC. Your ministry has cut physiotherapy services that help seniors. You've reduced the number of diabetes test strips that are available to help people manage their own care. As one nursing care provider has stated to me, and I quote, "The CCACs are great at spending dollars to save nickels." Yet the bigger issue of why up to 40% of the funds allocated to CCACs never makes it to frontline care has been something you've consistently ignored. Minister, why have you failed to ensure that the health care needs of vulnerable Ontarians are being met?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
I've had to make some pretty tough decisions as Minister of Health, and that party opposite has not stood with me as I have made tough decisions. Every decision I have made is about providing more care to people in their own home, Speaker. Our community care sector is growing. It is providing higher quality care to hundreds of thousands of more people, Speaker. I tell you, we do not have it perfect. It's a whole lot better than it was. And it is getting better. I remain open to ideas on how to get better value and better value and serve more people. That is what I live for, Speaker. So, are there better ways? I'm sure there are. We're listening, Speaker. But I will not get from the party that did not provide the home care that necessary.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Thank you. Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, the fact of the matter is that thousands of Ontarians are not able to access home care, executive salaries are skyrocketing, frontline service providers are not being paid the rates that they should be paid for personal support workers, up to 40% is spent on administration, there's a conflict of interest with CCACs directly hiring people. In fact, this is a mess, and the minister has stood by and let this happen. It's clear that we need urgent action to address the issue of the CCAs, Mr. Speaker, and that is why in the Standing Committee on Public Accounts tomorrow, I will be asking for an Auditor General's review of the operations. Here, here. Stand and support this request.
Oh, excellent.
You see the police? You see the police? Thank you. Minister?
Well, Speaker, of course I'll support the Auditor General looking at home care, which the Auditor General did in 2010 and did report back in 2012 and reported that patients were by and large satisfied with the services. The Auditor General also noted significant expansion in home care. The member opposite makes the case that more people need more home care. I could not agree more, Speaker, and that's why the last budget increased home care by 6%, home care and community care, and we continue to keep expanding home care. The member opposite talked about physiotherapy. Speaker, more people are getting faster access to physiotherapy now than they were under the old model, Speaker. We are transforming health care. Home care is at the foundation of that. Speaker, when I see people who are able to live at home because of the services provided by home care, I know we are on the right track.
Thank you. New question, the Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. I'd like to begin by taking the opportunity on behalf of New Democrats to welcome the new member for Thornhill to the legislature. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. The Premier may recall that in 2011, her government promised to reduce small business taxes from 4.5% to 4%. It was on page 13 of the Liberal fiscal framework. Can the Premier tell us what progress she's made thus far, Speaker?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. As the Leader of the Third Party knows, we recently, as a result of the last budget, gave small businesses a break, Mr. Speaker, on the employee health tax, Mr. Speaker. So we are very, very aware of the needs of small businesses, and we support them. That break on their payroll, Mr. Speaker, was designed precisely to support them and to make sure that they have the capacity to expand and to hire more people. That's why we made that change, Mr. Speaker.
So, thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Speaker, if we're going to grow and thrive, we need small businesses growing, creating jobs, innovating, and building our economy. Is the Premier going to keep her promise to cut small business taxes?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. As the Leader of the Third Party knows, we cut small business taxes from 5.5%, Mr. Speaker, to 4.5%. We have reduced. Extended the capital cost allowance to 2015, Mr. Speaker. We reduced the employee health tax on, I think it's 60,000 businesses, Mr. Speaker. So we have taken significant moves to support small business. But Mr. Speaker, the Leader of the Third Party needs to know that revenue is extremely important in terms of delivering services, Mr. Speaker, and cutting taxes across the board is not what we are going to do, Mr. Speaker. That may be what the Leader of the Opposition believes is important, Mr. Speaker. That's not what we're going to do, and I'm surprised if that's where the Leader of the Third Party wants to go, Mr. Speaker.
I'm going to remind the Attorney General, the Minister of Rural Affairs, the Minister of Immigration, that your Premier is answering a question while you're heckling. And I don't need any others. Final supplementary.
Speaker, earlier this morning I laid out a plan not just to increase the minimum wage, but also to help small business. New Democrats are calling for a $12 minimum wage by 2016, and we're calling for a cut to small business taxes. It's a responsible, affordable plan that will lift families out of poverty and ensure that small businesses can grow and create new jobs. Is the Premier open to a fair and balanced approach, Speaker?
Well, Mr. Speaker, we're actually taking a fair and balanced approach, and it would have been fantastic if the leader of the third party had fed into that consultation, had been part of the discussion before we brought our plan forward. This is an after-the-fact reaction, Mr. Speaker. Welcome to the discussion. That's great that she's brought a position forward, Mr. Speaker. But we brought together business leaders, we brought together workers, Mr. Speaker, we brought together academics, we brought together a table of people, and they found unanimity, Mr. Speaker, for a predictable process going forward to index the minimum wage to inflation, Mr. Speaker. We are going to be introducing legislation to do that. I hope that the leader of the third party would support us, Mr. Speaker. And as I say, we had an extensive consultation. It would have been fantastic if she had taken part in that, Mr. Speaker.
New question, leader of the third party.
Thank you, Speaker. My next question is also for the Premier. Statistics Canada recently released a report on the squeeze facing middle-class families, and it's not good news, Speaker. It says that the middle class isn't growing, and I quote, and I also quote, the middle class is no springboard to higher incomes, end quote. Does the Premier agree that the middle class is more squeezed than ever?
Premier.
Mr. Speaker, we have talked about this absolutely. We understand that that people are struggling, that it is important that they have the support of their government to make sure that they have the capacity to provide the opportunities that they need for their young people, for their parents. The discussion that the Minister of Health was just having about home care, Mr. Speaker, that's about providing opportunities for people to have supports at home and for their children and their grandchildren to get the supports that they need, Mr. Speaker. So yes, we are very aware. We are very aware that people in the middle class need support in terms of helping their young people to go to post-secondary, Mr. Speaker. That's what our 30% off tuition grant is about, Mr. Speaker. So we have put those supports in place. We will continue to do that work, Mr. Speaker, and we look forward to working with whoever in this House is willing to work with us, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Well, this weekend, one politician in Montreal expressed his concern. He said, and I quote, "We need to ensure that governments keep costs as low as possible, especially for middle-class households. The middle class is already having a hard time making ends meet and struggling with debt. Tax increases for them are not in the cards and not on the table," unquote. Justin Trudeau said that on Saturday. Speaker, does the Premier agree with her federal leader, Speaker?
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. But of course, if Justin Trudeau were the Prime Minister, we might have a partner in investing in children. We might have a partner in affordable housing, Mr. Speaker. We might have a partner in childcare, Mr. Speaker. We might have a partner that wouldn't cut our transfer payments and would stand up for Ontario, Mr. Speaker. So I look forward to working with Justin Trudeau as the Prime Minister of this country, Mr. Speaker. We will have a partnership that does not exist today.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Order. Just want to remind the members that as you do your interjections, I'm taking a mental note of who you are while you're speaking right over top of my discussion. Final supplementary.
Read his lips that they shouldn't be putting any new taxes on the middle class, Speaker.
That's right.
We should be focusing on making it easier for people to get into the middle class, not squeezing them out with new unfair taxes, Speaker. We should be focused on making life more fair. Families get that. New Democrats get that, Speaker. Apparently, even Justin Trudeau gets that. But this Premier doesn't seem to get it, Speaker. She wants new taxes on families, and she's getting ready to cut taxes for people that are making over $1 million a year, and she's creating creating new tax loopholes and giveaways for corporations. Does the Premier really think that's fair, Speaker?
So, Mr. Speaker, let me just be clear once again that what we believe is important is that people in this province have the infrastructure, and that means roads and bridges. Many of the members in the House have been to the Good Roads and the Roma meeting in the last couple of days, Mr. Speaker, and they know that every municipal leader there is concerned about investments in infrastructure, Mr. Speaker. They know that those municipalities need to have the support not just of the provincial government but of the federal government to make sure that they have the investments necessary, Mr. Speaker. So what I believe is that we have to make sure that that infrastructure is in place. And in my response to the first question, the point I was making is that if there were a federal partner, Mr. Speaker, who believed that investing in transit and roads and bridges in a systematic way across this province, that that was a priority, then we would be in a very different position, Mr. Speaker.
Your question? Member from Leeds Grenville.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Community Safety and Correctional Services.
Who is that?
I have to hand it to you. It's not easy getting 324 municipalities to agree. But you've done it at this year's Roma Ogre Conference. All 324 of Ontario's OPP-policed municipalities agree you failed to deliver on the biggest challenge they faced, policing costs. You're a year into the OPP billing review process and no closer to a fix. In fact, you've gone back to the drawing board because your first plan went down in flames. Now you're even farther away from the answer. How's that for leadership? Forget the solution for a minute and answer this for everybody at Roma Ogre. After your performance, why should municipalities have any confidence that you'll even get the job done?
I also want to remind a couple of members on this side that when your own member is asking the question, it's kind of nice for them to allow them to put the question without heckling. Minister of Community Service, the Minister of Energy will come to order. Minister of Community Service, and I'm still trying to acknowledge. The Minister of Community Services and Corrections, I know you're excited.
So excited about answering this question. I hope the member of the other side would have been with me when I met with the 50 more or more municipalities yesterday.
50 or more meetings.
Yes, a 36 delegation, you know, to talk about OPP cost. And I know that he was there this morning also to listen to the
order.
The commissioner of the OPP, Chris.
Member from Halton, come
Chris
to order.
Lewis, who explained,
you're on,
you know,
Bruce,
that
come to
the
order.
System that we have in place is not fair and is not transparent. A system that was put, I have to repeat that, by your party, sir. Even the Auditor General, the municipality were complaining, the police, the OPP knows it's not a good system in place, and the Auditor General also told us. So that's what we are transforming. So I've listened to the concern of the community. We have consulted with all the community.
Supplementary.
Well, Minister, let me tell you something. You're going to get no thank you cards from municipalities for what you've done to the OPP billing costs. You've let those municipalities down because you don't understand what's wrong. This isn't about tinkering with a costing formula to hurt some municipalities a little less than others. And it isn't about the service, because we all know and we all respect the OPP officers and the difficult job that they do. We need to solve the underlying problem. Policing costs are spiraling out of control. Our leader, Tim Hudak, reaffirmed today his commitment to ensure a piece of government that will reintroduce the Capacity to Pay Act and take the blank check away from arbitrators. That's a real plan to control costs for the long term, and you didn't need a fancy panel to tell you how to do it. So why don't you finally admit that you don't have a plan and use ours?
And in case the Minister of Infrastructure and Transportation didn't hear me because he was talking while I was trying to tell him to stop, stop. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I'm going to
the
member from Leeds Grenville that what's wrong? It's that there is municipality receiving 320 5 municipalities receiving OPP services. Some are paying zero, and some are paying $1,000. That's what is wrong, and that per household. So that's what we're trying to fix.
Yeah.
And we have a model that is in consultation as we speak, and this model will be transparent and fair to every municipality and every taxpayer in these municipalities.
The member from Leeds, Grenville, stop.
They are all very, very pleased with the service that the OPP is offering. I got it, you know, from every municipality. And
answer.
We're going to work with them. For those municipalities who will go from zero to another cost, and those who are paying $1,000
Thank
to
you.
The real cost they should pay, we will try
Thank you.
To help them.
Thank you. New question, the member from Niagara Falls.
Speaker, my question is to the Premier. Whether it's families who rely on paychecks from Virtus, DMI Industries, or Jarvis Street Parma, we see those paychecks gone. And people in Niagara see that the Liberal status quo isn't working for families. An increase to the minimum wage to $12 will ensure that families get a raise. Small business tax relief will ensure that small business
Stop the clock. Start the clock. Finish your question, please.
And small business tax relief will ensure that small businesses that are the backbone of the economies like Niagara can grow and create jobs. Does the Premier agree that families need an increase in the minimum wage to $12 by 2016 and that small businesses deserve a break?
Premier.
Mr. Labor.
Thank you very much, Speaker. First of all, I want to welcome the member to this House. I'm pleased to have a question for him. Just a reminder to the member, Speaker, that we established an advisory panel that was made up of Labor, business, anti-poverty and youth groups last June in 2013. They consulted Ontarians across this wide province. They had about 400 submissions. Speaker, how many submissions did the NDP make to that panel? Zero. Zero. How many questions, Speaker, the NDP has asked on the issue of minimum wage in this House? Zero. Up to the how many times did this member or his leader spoke in the by-election about minimum wage, Speaker? Zero. Speaker, their position is too little, too late. We're not interested in playing Sir. Crisis right in this House.
Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Supplementary.
Thank you. Now we've asked a question, maybe you can answer it. Mr. Speaker, small business is the backbone of our economy, and they're the backbone of Niagara. Small businesses' paychecks pay the bills for thousands of families. We need a balanced approach where families get a raise and ensure that we create more jobs by letting small businesses grow and thrive. Will the Premier agree to lower small business taxes to offset a meaningful increase to the minimum wage?
Speaker, I thank the member again for an important question. You know, part of the process that we engaged in was to ensure that we have thorough understanding and consultation with businesses, especially our small businesses across the province. That's why we made sure that the panel was consistent of representatives from both the retail sector and for the tourism sector, along with labor, along with anti-poverty groups and youth groups. And Speaker, one of the things that we heard again and again, and it's reported by the panel, is that businesses want predictability. They do not want an ad hoc process where numbers are pulled out of head, like NDP is suggesting now, which is too little, too late. What they want is a predictable system by which they can do business planning, and they know exactly what the minimum wage
should
be. And that's why we're going to be tabling a bill indexing minimum wage to cost of living, and I hope NDP supports that bill.
Thank you. Good question. The member from Oakville.
Thank you, Speaker. I've got a question this morning for the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Speaker, no parent wants their son or daughter
Order.
To suffer an acquired brain injury, but when tragedy strikes,
from Simcoe
they
North,
need to know
come
that
to order.
Will be there for them. Now, families in Oakville, Burlington, and Hamilton have been concerned recently about reports of changes in brain injury care at McMaster Children's Hospital. Recently, the member for Hamilton Mountain asked why these brain injuries are no longer being treated at that hospital. Now, I'd like to assure my constituents that the services are indeed still there and they're available when they need them. So, Speaker, would the minister tell this House what these changes mean for kids and their families in the Hamilton, Oakville and Burlington area?
Thank you. Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Well, thank you very much, Speaker. I'd like to thank the member from Oakville for giving me a chance to clear the air around these changes. I want to be absolutely clear, Speaker. McMaster Children's Hospital is still treating children with acquired brain injury, contrary to the assertions made by the member from Hamilton Mountain. In fact, the recent changes will allow patients to receive more timely care. Previously, the ABI, Acquired Brain Injury Clinic, ran twice a month. That sometimes caused a delay for patients from the time of injury, perhaps a concussion, perhaps other brain injury, Speaker. It was a delay from the time they received the injury to the time when they were seen in the clinic. Now patients with brain injuries, with head injuries, are seen within days in the pediatric neurosurgery clinic, where they're provided with a prompt assessment and referred to the appropriate
Answer.
Type of care. That care might be in the community, Speaker, or it might be more specialized care through Hamilton Health Sciences' Shadoke site.
Thank you.
Thank you, Speaker.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. I'm sure that all families in all of those communities I mentioned will be relieved to know this vital service is still provided by McMaster Children's Hospital. Kids with head injuries will now be cared for more effectively and efficiently. Now, Speaker, the Minister also mentioned the growing access to community care in her response. It's well known by all of us in this House that receiving the right care at the right time in the right place is a key commitment of the Action Plan for Healthcare. So, Speaker, would the Minister share with this House how increased investments in community care can benefit patients specifically with acquired brain injuries?
Good question.
Thank you, Minister.
Speaker, I'm very happy to have this question because living with an acquired brain injury can be very difficult for the individual and also for their families. So they need supports in their day-to-day lives, and I'm very proud to say we have nearly doubled funding for acquired brain injury since 2003. We've also increased our investments in assisted living by 124%, well more than doubled since 2003. And we're also helping in an increased way with services like Meals on Wheels, transportation services, home maintenance and repair. Speaker, these investments are helping dedicated workers and volunteers take care of Ontarians outside of hospitals, in their communities and in their homes. We will continue to work with people with acquired brain injuries and their advocates to continue this work.
Thank you. New question, the member from Parry Sound, Ms. Skolka.
Thank you much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier, and it's on the Far North Act. Premier, part of the problem with the Far North Act that your government passed in 2010 is that it puts half the Far North off limits for any development that might benefit the people who live and work in the North. Now, there's supposed to be land use planning done so that there are clear boundaries for the 225,000 square kilometres that can't be used to the benefit of Northerners. This uncertainty has been a particular challenge to those seeking to explore and develop the Far North. It's sending the wrong message.
Absolutely.
That the North is closed for business. So my question to you is this. Have you figured out exactly what 250,000 square kilometres of Northern Ontario are off limits for Northerners?
Premier.
Minister?
Minister of Natural Resources.
Minister of Natural Resources.
Thank you, Speaker, and I'm pleased to take the question from the member opposite. I think the member opposite knows full well that the Far North Planning Act is designed to create exactly what he's talking about, certainty. Because left to their government, there was considerable uncertainty. We had situations in the past where we've had mining activities, where we've had protests and blockades. We had the KI Platinex issue. Those are the kinds of circumstances we don't want evolving in Northern Ontario. And the member knows that the Far North Act is designed to create the certainty that both First Nations want and business wants. In fact, we've got five First Nations communities in Northern Ontario that have actually created land use planning that helped to create certainty in their communities. Speaker, you know what I would say to the member opposite with respect to this issue is that the Far North Act, although it may be for political opportunism, used to be misrepresented by people in Northern Ontario.
The member will withdraw.
Withdraw, Speaker.
His time is up. Supplementary.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And again, to the Premier, there's no denying that the Far North Act has cost Ontario jobs. We've been forced to watch as overlapping claims and government-imposed exclusion zones have wreaked havoc for exciting new mining projects. And when you eventually get around to mapping the half of Northern Ontario that is off-limits, what happens when a new remote mine or the next ring of fire is discovered right in the middle of it? You are set to deny Northerners the jobs and prosperity from future resource development when it is needed most. Premier, what is your plan B when you get the mapping wrong?
Minister.
Speaker, you know, the effort that we are making to ensure that the Far North Act and that the land use planning that's undertaken in the region gets it right is the partnerships that we're building with First Nations and the communities in the Far North that want to see economic benefits, that want to see land development, but they also want the certainty of land use planning. First Nation communities have indicated their support, and folks like Julie Denomi, the Vice President of the Sudbury Chamber of Commerce, also said, overall, we agree with the Act, we like it, and we see that there's value in it. So from both sides, Speaker, First Nations, communities, people who represent business in the Far North and represent communities, they agree that the Far North Act is something that is of value, creates certainty for businesses, and they support it, Speaker. And that's why
Thank
we
you.
Move forward with the legislation.
Question, member from London, Fanshawe.
My question is to the Minister of Health and Long-Term Care. Speaker, for years, New Democrats have urged this government to focus on delivering frontline care to patients instead of lining the pockets of health care executives. In December, we finally heard a promise from this government, but no action followed. This month, the exorbitant salaries and pay increases to CCAC and CEOs like London CEO Sandra Coleman's increase of 144% made the front page news.
Wow.
Yet, once again, Speaker, the minister made a promise to do something. But again, no action had been taken.
Again.
Can the minister explain why even outrageous salary increases like Ms. Coleman's do not inspire the minister to take action right now?
Thank you. Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
Thank you, Minister of Government Services.
Sir, Government Services.
Thank you very much.
They really love you.
It's great to be popular, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I'm happy to talk about our plans for executive compensation, but at the beginning, I just want to reiterate what the Minister of Health said about the improvements within community care in this province over the past 11 years. I remember, Mr. Speaker, quite frankly, it was one of the biggest issues in 2003, the cuts that have taken place under the previous government. And when you compare and contrast what's happened, Mr. Speaker, I'm very, very proud of the story this government can tell. In terms of executive compensation, Mr. Speaker, as I indicated in this House before Christmas, we will be coming forward shortly with legislation which will empower the government to undertake the analysis and work that
Answer.
Needs to be done to set forward frameworks complete with a hard cap to
Thank
deal
you.
With executive compensation
Thank
and
you.
Public service.
Mentory.
Speaker, I heard the House Leader say that he is proud of the story that this government has told. It's a horror story, Speaker. Speaker, so many of the people who deliver care continue to struggle to make ends meet, and they're the first ones to have their hours cut when this government is looking for cost savings in health care. Seniors who depend on the home care system keep telling us that they want improvements to the frontline care. But instead, we keep seeing the money that should be invested in care going to well-paid executives, Speaker, lining their pockets, Speaker. Why should Ontarians believe this minister that her latest promise to do something will result in action? And can we get a promise to see any kind of action anytime soon, Speaker?
Minister of Health and Long-Term Care, Mr. Speaker.
Minister.
Well, thank you, Speaker. I think it's time for a few facts. So let me share some facts with you, Speaker. The members opposite will know we used to have 42 CCACs. We now have 14, Speaker. That has saved $2 million in executive compensation, Speaker. The total percentage of CCAC budget spent on CEO salaries has been cut in half. When it comes to getting better care for patients, Speaker, CCACs have been leaders in transformation. Let me give you some examples. The Home First program, which supports people at home rather than waiting in hospital for long-term care, has been an extraordinary success. Internationally, Speaker, people are looking at this practice. In the Southwest alone, Home First has saved in 1 year $10 million and provided significantly higher quality of care. There are many examples I would love to share with the House on home care.
Thank you.
Speaker.
Question, the member from York South Weston.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the minister responsible for seniors affairs. Great. Speaker, I think that I can speak for everyone when I say that our seniors have contributed in a significant way to the success of this province. And I strongly believe that seniors continue to contribute to the prosperity and the foresight of our communities, our cities, and our province throughout their life. In my riding of York South Weston, I often meet with many senior groups who remain active and involved within their community, such as the York West Active Living Centre, the St. Fidelis Golden Age Group, Club 600. Groups such as these are a great example for all of us. Speaker, with inspiring seniors such as these across our province, what role does our government play in encouraging and in supporting active seniors?
Good question. Thank you, Minister responsible for senior affairs.
Speaker, let me welcome the member from Thornhill and Niagara as well. Congratulations to them. And let me say, Speaker, the member from York Southwestern, the tireless worker on behalf of the people of her constituency. But let me say, Speaker, that her seniors, they are no different than seniors in my area, the ones in Hamilton or Kingston or Leamington. They all have the same aspiration, Speaker. You know, and I know, Speaker, that growing old does not mean losing our place in society. Not at all, Speaker. It does not mean that we can no longer contribute, Speaker. To help do that, thanks to the help from our Premier and other members from the stakeholders, Speaker, on Friday we announced the first seniors grant program directly addressing seniors issues, Speaker. And I have to say that organizations such as the United Seniors of Ontario, such as Bernard Jordan, and
well, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thank you to the Minister for his commitment to the senior of our province. Our government has been driving the implementation of programs for seniors that will help to promote volunteerism, expand education and learning, and assist Ontario seniors in overcoming issues such as social isolation. Mr. Speaker, this grant program will go a long way in helping many of our seniors groups in my riding and beyond. Mr. Speaker, can the minister provide us with additional details regarding this important initiative?
Absolutely. Thank you, Minister.
Speaker, indeed, This is the first program that addresses the seniors directly for seniors in need, Speaker. And I'm delighted that the Ontario Senior Secretariat has been working very effectively in providing an application that is ready as of February 21st. It's ready, it's very simple, it's accessible to all the seniors groups. It aims to support groups of seniors for non-profit, of course. That is to engage them, Speaker, to get them out of isolation, bring them into community groups, keep them active, and that is the intent. And this is support as well on top of what we have already done through the Ontario Seniors Action Plan, Speaker. So this goes a long way in getting our seniors throughout Ontario. The grants are between $500 and $10,000, and it's in support of providing more effective activities and programs for our senior speakers.
Fantastic.
The member from Stormont, Dundas, and South.
I have a question for the Premier. Premier, municipal representatives from all over Ontario are gathered this week at the Roma Good Roads Convention.
Absolutely.
I have met with over 20 delegations, and the most expressed number one request was interest arbitration must be reformed, and it must be reformed now. Are you going to deliver on your promise to reform arbitration and save municipalities from bankruptcy?
Here, here.
Good Premier.
Thank you very much, Speaker, and I appreciate the member for the question. I had the great honor to be at the Roma OGRA conference, and in fact, I participated in the minister's session as well, along with our premier. And interestingly, Speaker, not a single member of the municipality asked me a question about interest arbitration yesterday, nor anybody requested a delegation. But that doesn't mean, Speaker, that we're not working on that very important issue. Speaker, as I've stated before in the House and as the Premier said it, we are very much committed to developing a new interest arbitration system in our province, which is fair and balanced, Speaker. But we will not bring any kind of scheme, as been suggested by the Leader of the Opposition, that may be unconstitutional, that is going to expose the municipalities to the kind of cost that they don't want, that they should not be incurring, Speaker. We are working on a model, Speaker, which is based on consensus, and I will provide you a little bit more details to that model in my supplementary. Thank you.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Again to the Premier. Premier, municipalities and rural residents need action today. Your indecision over any issue that may upset your public sector support base is causing misery.
That's right.
We have a plan, and we brought it to this legislature before. It is Bill 44, the Capacity to Pay Act, which AMO wanted to see examined in committee. You voted it down.
Oh.
Premier, do the right thing. Deliver on your commitment to the Association of Municipalities of Ontario and reform the interest arbitration now. Or does it take an Ontario PC bill to get things going?
Here, here.
You see it, please. You see it, please. Minister of Labour.
Thank you very much. As I mentioned, Speaker, we want to reform our interest arbitration system, which is fair and balanced. But we want to do it in a manner that is built on consensus. That's why, Speaker, I'm very proud that we have a process in place right now that has brought in the Association of Municipalities of Ontario, our firefighter partners, and our police associations, who are working together in building a model together that can actually work and help ensure that we have a fair and balanced system. The kind of bill that they propose, which this legislation voted against, Speaker, is not the way to go. It's unconstitutional, it's unilateral, and is not going to help the kind of relief that municipalities want. But, Speaker, what's important to note is what our municipalities were talking about yesterday at the Roma OGRA. They want to make sure that we continue to invest in our infrastructure, Speaker. They want to make sure that there are good roads and bridges in our communities.
Here, here.
And that's the kind of partnership,
answer,
Speaker, that we are continuing to build with our municipalities, along with ensuring that we continue with the $2 billion upload on social assistance costs that our government committed and will continue to do that.
Good question. Member Sloan.
Sorry.
Member from Canorie Rainier River.
Thank you, Speaker. To the Minister of Transportation. This winter, private snow clearing contractors in the north were fined for failing to meet road clearing standards, which confirmed what NDP MPPs have been saying for years, that the PC and Liberal privatization of road clearing is failing Northerners. Just this month, the Minister went on CBC Radio in Thunder Bay and said the Liberal government would look at bringing some of these services back in-house. He also apologized to those in the Northwest for our road conditions. When can Northern Ontario expect to see this government follow through on its promise to reverse the privatization of winter road maintenance?
Minister of Infrastructure and Transportation.
Thanks. Mr. Speaker, I met at Roma on Ontario Good Roads with all the municipalities affected, and we've worked out, I think, a plan and partnership to go forward to do reforms and to change the model, and we're working with the Ontario road builders, and we're very excited about that, Mr. Speaker. But, Mr. Speaker, the party opposite would take us back to $3 billion in infrastructure spending. That would reduce household incomes by $18,000, business income by $50,000. They're not talking about investments in public services. They both parties started this morning with a new tax cut.
Oh.
Do you know what? I have listened to municipalities from Cornwall to Kenora asking for better public services, better snow removal, better roads and bridges. We're now at 2% of GDP. Municipalities are 1%.
Thank you.
The federal government's missing in action. What are they going to start?
Thank you. Supplementary.
Minister, we're talking.
The question. I don't need your interjections. Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Maybe I should remind the minister we're talking about winter highway maintenance. This Liberal government keeps shifting blame, but the truth is that under this Liberal government, privatization of snow clearing contracts has increased and MTO oversight has decreased. In the Northwest, we've never seen 14 transport pileups before. In response to my question on snow clearing in November, the minister stated, quote, I will come to your constituency, I will meet with the contractor with you, and we'll make sure you get satisfaction, end quote. Since that time, I have contacted his office numerous times and received no response. Is the minister not responding because he's nervous about driving our roads, or is he planning to wait until spring when the snow is gone before following through on his commitment to come and see the conditions firsthand?
Mr. Speaker, we added 50 vehicles to Northern Roads this year, which was an unprecedented increase. I have met and talked with every mayor. We are maintaining standards and improving them. We met with about 17 municipalities this morning, Mr. Speaker, who have all said since those changes have been complete, the service in the north has been quite remarkable and good. And since the additional 16 vehicles were added, every single mayor said to me that they are pleased with the reforms and that. And we're not stopping there, Mr. Speaker. We have agreed to a practice of reform for next year to make additional improvements.
Good.
I'm still waiting for the third party to actually start addressing the issues raised at Roma and Ontario Good Roads, which is, what is their position on infrastructure funding? Will they maintain $15 billion, $14 billion? What is their position on municipal funding?
Thank you.
Do they have a position on anything that's important?
Thank you. New question, the member from Etobicoke North.
Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister for Service to the Consumers.
Purchasing a home, a place of one's very own, is part of the Canadian dream. Such purchases are usually the biggest transaction that people are likely to engage during their entire lives. This is especially true in my own riding of Etobicoke North. As stewards of this marketplace, the Government of Ontario must help people feel protected, informed, knowledgeable, and fully apprised of their options. This is not just a real estate transaction, but a visible and tangible correlate of people's hopes, dreams, and aspirations. In Ontario, Speaker, quite reasonably, we're finding more and more people
requesting
a home inspection before finalizing the purchase agreement. But how can we ensure that those home inspection reports are valid, sound, and up to standard? I'd ask the minister to please inform this chamber, how can we work collectively to make sure that Ontarians are protected when making this important, life-changing purchase?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. And I want to thank the member from Etobicoke North for this fabulous question, very
timely. Speaker, the House may or may not know that more than 70% of resale homes being inspected in Ontario aren't taking those inspections, which is 140,000 homes next year, Speaker. That's a lot of home inspections. And the member is correct in saying that a home inspection that's sound, conducted by someone who's trained and experienced and professional, can provide that sense of assurance and confidence before people make a big purchase, often their biggest one, and sign on a dotted line. The member is also correct in saying that there is currently no minimum standard, no qualification standard whatsoever for home inspectors in this province. There's many good ones, Speaker, but there's no standards. That's why we established a panel of experts, and the panel has met several times. A report has been submitted, and we are currently reviewing the report for the next steps. Thank you.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker, and thanks as well to you, Minister, for addressing this important file. I know that constituents in my own riding of Etobicoke North will benefit from this added scrutiny of the home inspection domain. Speaker, as a government, of course, it's important for us to ensure that all Ontarians trust and have confidence in the goods and services they are buying. The larger the purchase, the more important it is that there's equity and transparency. As the qualifications and changes to the sector being considered will be of huge importance and will impact home buying decisions across Ontario, can the minister please share with this House when can we expect these decisions to be made to benefit potential home buyers?
Thank you, Minister.
Thanks again, Speaker. After we received the report, it was posted on the Ontario's government registry from mid-December to January 27th, and the next step, of course, is to analyze both the panel's recommendation as well as the feedback we received from the public. We have every intention of moving forward with this very, very soon. And when we do, Speaker, I certainly hope, I really hope that we will have all party support for this legislation. I am confident that our government's not alone in caring about the fate of home purchasers in Ontario. And I want to thank the panel, all the members who worked on the panel in getting us to this point, and I look forward to bringing something forward to the House very, very soon. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. A new question, the member from Oxford.
Speaker, Mr. Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Agriculture and Food. Minister, you know that the agri-food industry not only provides significant economic output, they purchase the majority of our farmers' products. 4 months ago, you told the agri-food industry to double their growth, but didn't do nothing to make that possible. Premier, these businesses want to grow. It's your government that's holding them back. We've heard from the food processors that their biggest challenge is the massive hydro increases. In fact, we've heard that many of them have told you the same thing. As Premier and Minister of Agriculture, have you done anything at all to deal with these hydro increases hitting these food processors?
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And I know that the Minister of Energy will want to speak generally to the energy sector in the supplementary. But what I want to say, Mr. Speaker, is that we are very aware that supporting the food processing industry right now is extremely important, Mr. Speaker. The Minister of Children and Youth Services made an announcement on Friday with Thomas Canning, Mr. Speaker, an investment that will help that organization to grow, Mr. Speaker, and to create 40 new full-time jobs. So we're very, very keen, Mr. Speaker, on supporting the agri-food sector. And when I posed the challenge to the food processing and agri-food sector, Mr. Speaker, I said that we were not expecting them to go it alone. We knew that they would need support and investment from government. We are right there with them,
Mr.
Speaker. And in fact, the food processors of Ontario have set out a plan. They know what their objectives are, and they know they have a partner in this government, Mr.
That's
Speaker.
Right.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Premier, since you issued your challenge, Heinz and Kellogg's both announced closures. That's 1,260 jobs. Add the 40 jobs that you just talked about, that's still a loss of 1,220 jobs. Food manufacturers are facing challenges caused by your government. Research by the CFIB, Alliance of Canadian Ontario Food Processors, and our caucus show that. These businesses are struggling with red tape, trade barriers, and high cost of operating in Ontario. 2 weeks ago, I wrote you and asked to support the Millions Jobs Act to reverse your government's policies that are forcing businesses out of Ontario. It would create jobs and help food processors meet your challenge. Premier, will you help these businesses by to grow by supporting the Million Jobs Act introduced by our leader, Tim Huda.
Minister of Economic Development, Trade and Employment.
Mr. Speaker, you know, one of the great things about the Southwestern Ontario Development Fund that has created and retained nearly 24,000 jobs together with the Eastern Ontario Development Fund is that 95% of the investments go to manufacturing, and many of those are in food processing. I'm just going to name a few. Original Foods in Dunnville, I had the pleasure of being at the opening, 150 new jobs. Armstrong Milling, 10 jobs in Hagersville. Conestoga Meats, 100 jobs in Breslau. Elmira Pet Products, 25 jobs in Elmira. And the list goes on. Natra in London, I was there with the Minister of Health just a couple of weeks ago. 56 jobs there as well, and NutriBlend Foods in Brantford, 53 new jobs. That's in addition to the many hundreds of jobs that are retained. That's just in the last few months, and I'd be happy to continue the list.
We're from Oxford, you asked. Listen. New question, the member from Welland.
My question's to the Minister of Energy. Under this government's watch, electricity prices have doubled in this province. And while power gets sold across the border to New York State at a fraction of what Ontarians pay, the Well and Curling Club in my riding is in danger of closing because of sky-high hydro bills. How does this government justify the doubling of hydro rates, the doubling of electricity prices, and the pain that it's causing residents throughout the province, including my home riding of Welland?
Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, we have made significant investments in the energy sector, in transmission and generation. That created price pressures. We created a number of price mitigation programs, Mr. Speaker, to assist companies. And one of those was the Industrial Electricity Incentive. Mr. Speaker, as of January 2013, industrial companies could be eligible for electricity rates among the lowest in North America if they started or expanded operations and created jobs through this program.
Minister, stop the clock. The member from Northumberland is warned. Carry on.
You're under the IEI program. Last month, Detour Gold was one of the successful proponents in the first round and claims that the program will save them $20 million in 2014. This program, Mr. Speaker, uses surplus electricity, and we are providing it to companies in Ontario rather than exporting it to New York or anywhere else where they can use it against us, Mr. Speaker.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. Community clubs like the Well and Curling Club are at the heart of social life in our communities. If these clubs are being hurt because of skyrocketing electricity prices, it means that community arenas, community social clubs, community curling clubs are going to be affected. There are 60,000 curlers in this province, and there are 100 curling clubs at risk of closing because of these high rates. How does this government justify doubling the electricity prices under its watch and the harm that it's bringing to our local communities? What is this government going to do to help the skaters, the hockey players, and the curlers in this province to make sure that these avenues that are available to them today are going to remain open this year and next year?
Question.
For people in this province.
Thank you. Minister of Energy.
Mr. Speaker, that party has no position on energy whatsoever.
Exactly.
I understand they haven't said so, but they don't support new nuclear. They continually get up and oppose nuclear refurbishment. Mr. Speaker, that represents 50% of the generation in the province of Ontario. Mr. Speaker, their plan on energy, their program is a blank sheet.
Oh.
We don't know what they will do, Mr. Speaker. What will they do to mitigate rates? Mr. Speaker, when we released our long-term energy plan, both leaders were asked what could they do to reduce rates. Mr. Speaker,
say?
The Leader of the Opposition said, can he reduce rates? The answer is no on that.
Oh, okay.
They
that's
asked the
know.
Leader of the third party, would she be able to reduce rates? The answer was no on that.
Oh,
Mr. Speaker, we're working on reducing rates, and we'll have more to announce in the near future.
Thank you. Leader of the Opposition on a point of order.
I just appreciate this. I just want to introduce a good friend who's been a very strong advisor to me on small-town economic development and agribusiness issues is Albert Vitteveen. He's from class 15 of the member for the Advanced Agriculture Leadership Program. In the gallery there, so I just wanted to welcome to Queen's Park and thank all
the Minister of Community Services and Corrections.
Mr. Speaker, I want to correct my record. I think that I've said that the UPP is policing 325 municipalities. It's 324
municipalities. Thank you. There's a point of order. A member from...
I found that inappropriate. So just... The member from Oxford on a point of order.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. On a point of order, I'd like to introduce Myron Gerber. He's a member of the Class of 15 of the Advanced Agriculture Leadership Program, is here with us today.
Thank you.
And I'd like to say welcome.
Lambton Kent, Middlesex.
I'd like to welcome, from my riding of Lambton Kent, Middlesex, Gabriel Ferguson and Aaron Wright, who are here for the Advanced Agriculture Leadership Program.
Thank you. Northumberland, Quinty West.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. It's nice to be noticed in the House. I'd like to greet Lori...
Don't worry, I do.
Lori Calvey from Northumberland, Quinty West. She's a member of the Class of 15 in the Advanced Agricultural Leadership Program. I want to welcome her to Queen's
Thank
Park.
You. Member from Durham.
I'd like to recognize Marlene Wherry from the Agricultural Leadership Group, as well as Kate Barry Hyatt from the Class of Advanced Agricultural Leadership. Welcome to Queen's
Park. Scarborough Gilwood.
To welcome the grade 9 class from my riding, from Maplewood High School, and they're from the Kingston Galloway area.
Thank you, Durham Bruce.
Thank you very much. And I would like to welcome the rest of the Class of 15, the Advanced Agricultural Leadership Program, Sabrina Bladen, Claire Cow, and Donna Downey, Tom Farifus, Heather Hargrave, Kate Hyatt, and Henriette Buren, as well as Arlene Werner. They are all here to experience question period today.
Thank you. I do have one quick announcement myself before I move to where we're supposed to be. I do want to give you a gentle and subtle reminder that we have changed how we do introductions for purpose so that we avoid what we just did. So please, even if they're not here, introduce them during the times of introductions, and I will give us as much leeway as we need. But if we keep doing this, well, then we're just reinventing the same thing and adding more time to your valuable time during question period and debate. Thank you. We do have a deferred vote on the motion for interim supply, so we'll call in the members. This will be a 5-minute bell.
Members, take their seats, please. All members, take their seats, please. Bob.
I might need a break next vote.
On February 24th, Mr. Malloy moved that the Minister of Finance be authorized to pay the salaries of the civil servants and the necessary payments pending the voting of supply for the period commencing April 1st, 2014 and ending on September 30th, 2014. Such payments shall be charged to the proper appropriations for the 2014-2015 fiscal year. Following the voting of supply, all those in favour will rise one at a time, be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Malloy.
Mr. Malloy.
Mr. Bradley.
Bradley.
Mr. Gerritsen.
Mr. Gerritsen.
Mrs. Jeffrey.
Mrs. Jeffrey.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Madame Mayeur.
Madame Mayeur.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Berardinetti.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mrs. Cansfield.
Mrs. Cansfield.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Ms. Peruzza.
Ms. Peruzza.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. McNeely.
Mr. McNeely.
Mr. Padre.
Mr. Padre.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Rossetti.
Mr. Rossetti.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Nacri.
Mr. Nacri.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Jassett.
Ms. Jassett.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Ms. Genova.
Ms. Genova.
Mr. Marchese.
Mr. Marchese.
Madame Jelena.
Madame Jelena.
Mr. Crew.
Mr. Crew.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Nadishak.
Mr. Nadishak.
Mr. Tavis.
Mr. Tavis.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Forrester.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Shine.
Mr. Shine.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
You want to pay your bills?
All those opposed, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mrs. Elliott.
Mrs. Elliott.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Ms. McLeod.
Ms. McLeod.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Cleese.
Mr. Cleese.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. McNaught.
Mr. McNaught.
Mr. Dunlop.
Mr. Dunlop.
Mr. Holliday.
Mr. Holliday.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Chudley.
Mr. Chudley.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. O'Toole.
Mr. O'Toole.
Mr. Willett.
Mr. Willett.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Jackson.
Mr. Jackson.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Ura.
Mr. Ura.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mrs. McKenna.
Mrs. McKenna.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Leone.
Mr. Leone.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Milligan.
Mr. Milligan.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Being 65 and the nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. We have a deferred vote on government. We have deferred votes on government orders 11 through to 21 inclusive. Calling the members, this will be a 5-minute bell.
Mr. Malloy has moved concurrence and supply for the Ministry of Finance. All those in favour, please rise one at a time and be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Malloy.
Mr. Malloy.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Bradley.
Mr. Gerritsen.
Mr. Gerritsen.
Mrs. Jeffrey.
Mrs. Jeffrey.
Mr. Souza.
Mr. Souza.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Madame Ayer.
Madame Ayer.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. McCharles.
Ms. McCharles.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Quinter.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Takar.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Bardinetti.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mrs. Cansfield.
Mrs. Cansfield.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Ms. Peruzza.
Ms. Peruzza.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Leal.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. McNeely.
Mr. McNeely.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Moridi.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Coteau.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Nackby.
Mr. Nackby.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Balkison.
Mr. Balkison.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Jasek.
Ms. Jasek.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Domerla.
Ms. Domerla.
Mr. Kraft.
Mr. Kraft.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Ms. DeNova.
Ms. DeNova.
Mr. Marchese.
Mr. Marchese.
Madame Gelina.
Madame Gelina.
Mr. Prue.
Mr. Prue.
Ms. Taylor.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Nadesha.
Mr. Nadesha.
Mr. Tavis.
Mr. Tavis.
Mr. Singh.
Mr. Singh.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forster.
Ms. Forster.
Ms. Campbell.
Ms. Campbell.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Vantoff.
Mr. Shine.
Mr. Shine.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller Hamilton East Stony Creek.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. You recognize by the clerk.
Mr. Hudak. Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Arna.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mrs. Elliott.
Mrs. Elliott.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mrs. McLeod.
Mrs. McLeod.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Miller Perry Sound Muskoka.
Mr. Cleese.
Mr. Cleese.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. Dunlop.
Mr. Dunlop.
Mr. Holliday.
Mr. Holliday.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mrs. Monroe.
Mr. Chudley.
Mr. Chudley.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. O'Toole.
Mr. O'Toole.
Mr. Willett.
Mr. Willett.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Jackson.
Mr. Jackson.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Mr. Urich.
Mr. Urich.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mrs. McKenna.
Mrs. McKenna.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Leone.
Mr. Leone.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Pettipiece.
Mr. Milligan.
Mr. Milligan.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau. The ayes are 65, the nays are 35.
The ayes being 65 and the nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Malloy has moved concurrence and supply for the Ministry of Tourism, Culture and Sport. All those in favour, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk. Same vote? Agreed.
The ayes are 65, the nays are 35.
The ayes being 65 and the nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Malloy has moved concurrence and supply with the Ministry of Health and Long-Term Care. All those in favour, rise one at a time. Same vote? Same vote.
The ayes are 65, the nays are 35.
The ayes being 65, the nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Malloy has moved concurrence with supply of the Ministry of Transportation. All those in favour, rise one at a time. Same vote? Same vote.
The ayes are 65, the nays are 35.
The ayes being 65, the nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Malloy moved concurrent supply for the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs. All those in favour, please rise. Same vote. Same vote.
The ayes are 65, the nays are 35.
Ayes being 65, nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Malloy moved concurrent supply for the Minister of Energy. All those in favour, please rise. Same vote. Same vote.
The ayes are 65, the nays are 35.
The ayes being 65, nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Malloy has moved concurrence in supply for the Ministry of Education. All those in favour, please rise. Same vote. Same vote.
The ayes are 65, the nays are 35.
The ayes being 65, the nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Malloy has moved concurrence in supply of the Ministry of Infrastructure and Transportation. All those in favour, same vote. Same vote.
The ayes are 65, the nays are 35.
The ayes being 65, nays being 35, I declare the motion carried.
Mr. Malloy has moved concurrence to supply Ministry of Children and Youth Services. All those in favour, please rise one at a time. Same vote. Same vote.
The ayes are 65, the nays are 35.
The ayes being 65, the nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Malloy has moved concurrence to supply of the Office of Francophone Affairs. All those in favour, please rise. Same vote. Same vote.
The ayes are 65, the nays are 35.
The ayes being 65, the nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. Mr. Malloy has moved concurrence and supply for the Ministry of Consumer and Services. All those in favour, please rise. Same vote. Same vote.
The ayes are 65, the nays are 35.
The ayes being 65 and the nays being 35, I declare the motion carried. There are no further deferred votes. This House, the member from Durham on a point of order.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Earlier today, the member from Ajax Pickering put on each member's desk an invitation to the Durham Days on March the 3rd. The point of order is really the tradition here has been to respect all members representing the area that's being celebrated on Monday in this case. When I looked at the material, I was quite disappointed that it was organized by the member from Ajax Pickering. And the issue is I called the regional chairman to see, because in order, the member from Whitby Oshawa, as well as the member from Oshawa, as well as the member from Cawthra Lakes Brock, were not featured as MPPs on the brochure. That was the first thing. And secondly, there were pictures of the two Liberal members on the material. Now, the regional chairman had not seen the material and nor signed off. This is an important event in Durham. All five members should be recognized. And my point is this: who paid for it? Who approved it? And we were never consulted on this. That is shameful.
I really find it difficult to rule on something that the member continues to debate. And the Minister of Energy is not being helpful. That is not in particular a point of order here, except I will take the member's word that the material about distributing materials in this House completely. Members have the right to distribute materials, but I caution, and I offer it as a serious caution, that it should not have any political overtones in it whatsoever. It is not permitted, and that if within the I would also recommend that in this particular case, this is something that should be taken up with the group that is organizing this particular event and ensure that it doesn't happen again. And I want to offer that caution one more time. Nothing in this building is supposed to be political in nature as distributed by anybody, including your staff. It should not be displayed in windows. It should not be put on the tables here. And we've dealt with this a couple of times, and I'm using this as a reminder that is not to be done. This House, there are no further deferred votes. This House stands recessed until 3 p.m. this afternoon.